My name's Carl Meyer. I'm a marine biologist and I grew up on a small island. I've never lived more than 1 mile from the ocean. And I've always been interested in the ocean and fishing and fish. And that inspired my career aspirations. So even when I was in elementary school, I wanted to be a marine biologist. And I followed that path all the way through to where I am today.
That's amazing. I love it that when people are able to conceptualize something they would like to do for the rest of their lives, and they're actually able to follow through and go through with it. So well done.
But Sandy, I didn't realize I was going to become a desk-bound bureaucrat when I was having those childhood dreams.
It's always with a twist, right? Kind of
Yeah, exactly.
like for me, I always growing up wanted to be an archaeologist, and I ended up becoming a Foucauldian archaeologist. And so, like, I don't dig in the dirt, but I do dig in the dirt of history. So, yeah, it's interesting the way that twist happens. All right. Well, tell me a bit about this program that you're doing with the Waikiki Aquarium, and it's all about sharks. So, tell me a bit about this.
Okay, so I'm giving a lecture, and the title is Science Reveals the Secret Lives of Sharks. And the lecture is going to highlight some of the discoveries that we've made that have deepened our understanding of how sharks live in their challenging environment. And it's also going to showcase our research into solutions for reducing shark-human conflicts. And these are things like shark bites on ocean users, shark bycatch, and catch depredation, which is where sharks come in and steal or damage fish catches.
So, as we've kind of seen over the last, like 15 years of documentaries that are really kind of covering this, while sharks are predators, they're not jaws, right? So, can you talk to us a little bit about what sharks are really like and what kind of respect we're supposed to be showing them? Because obviously there's a respect situation happening, but they're not just hunting for humans, right?
That's right. So sharks have something of a bad rap as being dangerous animals. It's true that they occasionally do bite people, and I wouldn't trivialize those events. I mean, they're very tragic if you're bitten by a shark, but they're very rare. And sharks play a really vital role in ocean health. So they are meso or apex predators that play an important role in food web dynamics. So, because of their activities, the rest of the food chain is healthier. And so, it's very important to have them in our ecosystem. And in our modern age, they actually face probably more threats than at any other time throughout our history. And that's because of things like industrial fishing. And so, if we overexploit shark populations, reduce their numbers, it's going to have potentially negative cascading effects on the rest of the marine food web. And that's why it's important to conserve these predators.
Well, that's very interesting. So, can you tell us a bit about what people can expect from this lecture? What kind of things are they going to learn? And why is it even important that they learn these things?
Well, I'm going to explain our research focus to them and tell them about some of our discoveries. And this includes both fundamental work where we are just trying to understand how sharks survive in this challenging ocean environment and what role they play, but also talk about how we take this knowledge and we try to apply it to improving shark-human relations, looking for solutions to these gritty problems like sharks biting people, and also people catching sharks when they don't want to, and sharks damaging fish catches, which is bad for, the fisheries and the sharks. So I'm going to be covering all of those topics and also placing this in a broader historical context so people can understand that we really live in an exciting time of discovery that's very different from most of human history when it comes to understanding sharks.
Well, it sounds like it's going to be an incredibly informative lecture. So it's going to be for people who work in marine industries, for people who are recreational in the water. Sounds like it would cover a broad spectrum of audience members.
Yeah, so it's really tailored to engage the general public. Anybody who has an interest in sharks or ocean activities or is into fishing. So it's going to be quite broad in its focus and avoiding dry technicalities to the extent possible.
Oh, yeah. So for all those kids out there who want to become a re marine biologist, what kind of advice do you have for them?
Well, the path is actually fairly obvious. You have to work hard in school and you have to focus on subjects like science and math. And it really helps if you can gain life experience in marine activities to help sort of ground you as a biologist. And so that's things like taking opportunities to volunteer if they're available at local aquaria or for agencies that have internal volunteer programs that help them to run their missions. And the reason is that when you go through this process and you are looking for career opportunities as a marine biologist, it's actually a highly competitive field. So I, for example, each year I get 200 to 300 people contacting me asking if they can join our lab as graduate students. And obviously I can't take all of those people. Many of them are very well qualified and looking for opportunities. So you have to sort of strengthen your resume with both what I'd call conventional academics. You know, you went and you studied math and science and you got a good scores in school, and you went to undergrad and you got good scores there. But we're also looking for folks that have some sort of practical experience if we can find it. So that's the advice I give to people is, yeah, focus on the maths and the science, but also try and get practical experience. Go and volunteer, and that will help to set you above the pack when it comes to competing for these limited opportunities.
Yeah, and I would imagine that the two would kind of feed off of each other. It's like the more you're in the marine life world, you are more intrigued with the math and the science. And the more you learn the math and the science, the more you understand what you're seeing out there. So they just kind of feed on one another.
Yeah, and it depends on the type of marine biology you want to do. I mean, our field is very, we need to have a sort of an unusual combination of skills. So we need to be able to code statistical analyses in R, but we also have to be able to build fishing gear, operate boats, and do a lot of different things. And so you want to, depending on the type of marine biology you're going to pursue, you want to develop a portfolio of skills that matches your career aspirations, because that makes you a much stronger candidate when you are either looking for places in graduate school or for a job. You know, employers are going to look at what you have on your resume and see, you know, think about how you would fit into their organization. So it needs to be this portfolio of skills that you develop.